So the Zimbabwean election in 2018 has come. The votes have been counted. Parliamentary ZANU-PF has emerged as the winner. But there are great challenges for the Zimbabwean government going forward. And with me, I have one of the most accomplished Zimbabwean experts, somebody that is working elsewhere, Dr. Mthuli Ncube. He has been requested, he's been asked, he's been looked for by many people in and outside government, and he's been encouraged to come back to Zimbabwe and assist. So Dr. Ncube, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
So if I begin by saying, if you were drafted in by any presidential winner, at a night before the inauguration, and they say, I have a country to run, the politics is done, the economics is about to begin to be done, but where should I stop? What would you be saying to them?
Well, frankly, there's a lot of work to do on the economic front. What's important, first of all, is really to craft a very clear economic vision, a strategy for the country. I would say really what's important is to create an economy that exhibits strong growth that is very strong, at least 6% rate of growth in terms of GDP growth over a period of 10 years. So it should be sustained, but also it should be shared. The real evidence in growth that is shared is through job creation and in opportunities in business and other opportunities. Now, to achieve that vision of strong growth, which is sustained, which is shared and inclusive, you need to start somewhere. There's some immediate steps to embark on. The first one is to restore the international credibility and image of the country in terms of its credit worthiness. So what one will do then is to make sure that we deal with Zimbabwe's external debt. There are two parts to that. The first part is the debt that is owed to, you know, multilateral institutions such as the African Development Bank and the World Bank, and that needs to be dealt with first before any credit or monies can flow from those kind of institutions, the IFIs. Then we move on to the second stage, which is the Paris Club debt, which amounts to about $4.5 billion or so at least. So the bilateral institutions, and that again needs to be renegotiated, needs to be restructured. We need probably a HIPC-like mechanism similar to what Myanmar did or Yugoslavia did. There are so many models as how to deal with that. That will then restore credit to begin to flow into our banking sector, into our companies to finance the manufacturing sector. Once that is done and the country begins to build reserves through these inflows, you can then be able to reintroduce a Zimbabwe dollar or whatever we call it in future. One needs to be clear about the timeline and be careful how that is arrived at. And then we can then restore monetary policy, because at the moment there is no monetary policy. You have banking supervision as one leg of the central bank, the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe, but there's no monetary policy in terms of drip feeding the system so that the economy grows. And then you move on. What's also urgent as part of the package is to deal with the fiscal front in terms of government expenditure. A budget deficit of over 10% is never a good thing. It just doesn't look good for investors. So dealing with that and driving it down to the order of 5% GDP as a percent of GDP is really that should be the target. 3% is even better. And then by correcting that, you also correct things on the current account side. Zimbabwe has always been a kind of a deficit current account country to remain there, but it shouldn't be too large. So you change the entire macro picture and restore credibility in that macro picture.
Right. When you look at the system now as it is, liquidity in the country, you were using the US dollar.
Yes.
But also because the country is under sanctions,
yes.
It is not able to sustain that. There was a lot of bleeding of whatever the central bank was trying to bring back in. Are there immediate solutions that are visible? Because politicians want to see something or to demonstrate to the country that there is activity, there's evidence of delivery. Are there things in the short term that can actually be done, or you just have to rely on a long-term strategy?
If you had asked me this question 3 years ago, and I was one of the first people to argue that Zimbabwe must adopt the South Africa rand and join the rand monetary area for a 7-year period or 10-year period. Why? Because South Africa accounts for Zimbabwe's exports in terms of 80% of all trade is with South Africa. So clearly you want a currency that is linked to your largest trading partner. But I don't think I want to argue that now things have moved on. I did actually quite a lot of scientific research on that issue. Things have moved on now, I think we're at a new juncture. So what I would argue now is that we have to remove the bond notes currency, which is becoming a surrogate Zimbabwe dollar, but without the macroeconomic credibility, no monetary policy credibility to support it. So that should be removed because it is bad money. And we know that in economics, bad money dries out good money. It's not surprising that even the US dollars are now in short supply because people are not banking those. They're keeping them under the mattress, to use a very simple phrase. So I would say immediate course of action is to remove the bond notes, let the US dollar again be the core currency of focus. But over time, we have to bring back the Zimbabwe domestic currency. That's what will deal with liquidity issues in a very big way. It is very successful.
Yeah, there's also, you spoke mainly about the foreign debt that the country has. But there's also the issue of domestic debt. There's the issue of what happened during the course of the dollarization. So if someone in a village in Gwanda, where my mother comes from, was listening, they would be saying, what is Dr. Ncube suggesting should be done with respect to giving confidence to whatever the central bank or the Minister of Finance in any new government should do?
You know, the issue of domestic debt, for example, that issue needs to be dealt with through government expenditure patterns. If you have easily 80% of government expenditure is focused on wages, so it's not productive, that picture needs to change where you begin to see a bigger share going to the more productive, the more investment part of government activity and not expenditure part. So that needs to be managed better in terms of managing government or court coffers. There are people who lost monies during the dollarization. That issue still has not been completely resolved. I think we need to go back and look at it and see how best to resolve that and restore people lost. But the ultimate confidence for anyone in the street in Zimbabwe is jobs. Once credit lines are flowing, once the financial sector is strong enough to start lending again to manufacturing, to the productive sector, and starts creating jobs, then people really feel confidence is back. Jobs are the silver bullet in any economy, absolutely. But I must say this, though, that going forward, there's also need to think about the long-term issues around skills development. Because you need to create a cadre of youngsters going forward who are job ready. How do you make them job ready? It means maybe doing some reforms in the education sector and bringing a stronger element of vocational education. There's no reason why a child finishing A-levels in Zimbabwe shouldn't walk away with an artisanal skill. Maybe whether it's carpentry or whatever it is, some artisanal is possible. Or indeed, we do a bifurcation that used to happen in the past. In Switzerland still, that's where I live, so I know the system well. They're still practicing the bifurcated system where there's vocational education track at the age of 16, and those who want to carry on to university do that. So thinking about that, creating a much more job-ready cadre of the youth is also key to job creation. You have to bring in the companies into that. So a partnership between the government, the training institutions, and the corporates and parastatals is key to creating such an education system. And by the way, this is a problem that I'm seeing in a good part of Africa, be it South Africa, or Nigeria, or Ghana, Ethiopia. We're all facing the same problems in terms of job creation and creating a cadre of youth who are skills. Of course, there are other issues such as infrastructure investment. In Zimbabwe, the infrastructure investment constraint is dampening growth by as much as 3%. So there's need to invest a lot more in infrastructure, in maintenance, but also we have to innovate. We need smart infrastructure. It sounds like it's dreaming when you think of cable cars. I won't mention the country where I actually advocated cable cars in a very crowded city and supported investors, and they've just done exactly that. So all the traffic jams,
we have to be creative about our infrastructure. More solar energy, maybe less coal, although you have to balance that with job creation. We just have to be smart about that. So investing in infrastructure is critical. Our health sector, again the same. Why don't we have specialist hospitals? Every other middle class person flies to a different country for treatment for eyes, for diabetes and whatever. Those are institutions that could be built in Zimbabwe in terms of referral hospital. There's a lot of work to do at the sectoral level to support the vision of strong, sustained and shared growth.
Right, Dr. Ngube, you have already spoken about giving ideas to a different country that's benefiting from that in so many ways. But there are so many people who will say, you living in the diaspora, being a Zimbabwean, there are so many other friends that you share these ideas with, that you discuss with, that could potentially come back to Zimbabwe or bring the ideas to Zimbabwe. Where do you see the challenge being for the government to accept or to be receptive, or to put a red carpet to all these ideas and these Zimbabweans that are in the diaspora to make a contribution going forward?
There shouldn't be a problem. The Zimbabwe government, Zimbabwe must invite all the skilled Zimbabweans out there to come back and contribute. Some of them don't have to come back physically. They could be stay where they are and contribute through certain structures. Maybe not everyone can be accommodated. That's also okay. But also, you know, there's another role that Zimbabweans out there can play. For instance, I think that Zimbabwe must establish an international economic advisory council where you bring in Zimbabweans who are out there who may not want to come back, but also infuse that with foreign skills. And you spread that right across the globe and say, have someone from the US, Europe, UK, Germany, Japan, Korea, China, be part of that advisory board and advise government or government institutions as to the environment out there, best practice, and you need different skills in that and infuse that those skills into how our government goes around crafting policy and enacting policy and creating an environment that is really good, that is really open for business by improving the cost of doing business, the speed of doing business. There's no reason why Zimbabwe cannot catch up with its compatriots such as Rwanda in improvement in terms of the doing business indicators every year. That should be a target. I want to add one thing. Of course, I'm talking about foreign investors coming in. How about domestic investors? Sometimes we forget about the role of domestic direct investment as opposed to foreign direct investment, FDI. So DDI versus FDI. That's also important. For instance, creating a kind of national venture fund funded by banking sectors, shareholders, pension fund, and so forth, to support new industries, current industries, and take equity right across. There was a time when there was a very successful instrument like that in the market, in the Zimbabwe market. But that is gone. That needs to be restored, and it works. And again, I've suggested it in another country, which I'll not mention, they've implemented. It seems to be working, because without the counterpart domestic investors, sometimes foreign investors can't come in because they don't see who else is there, who has something to lose that they could partner with and protect everyone's interests.
Right. The Zimbabwe government has struggled over the last few years, probably in the last decade, in terms of collecting revenue internally, because the economy is informalized. So there will be a lot of people, some of them making good money, but nobody, including some ministers, I understand, who have farms, but there is no instrument. It would appear that the Minister of Finance in Zimbabwe is weak as an institution in terms of collecting revenue throughout the country, whether it's through Zimbra or whatever else, which is why one political party was suggesting that the informal sector should be formalized. And then, so how would you advise the new government in looking at how they should improve on collecting revenue?
Of course, there's the issue of just getting strong, sustained growth, you know, on the right trajectory. As I say, minimum 6% per annum over 10 years and moves them up to middle income status. That should be the aim. And that should generate collectible and taxable revenues from across the economy. That's one thing. But then there's the issue of the systems for collection. There's been a vast improvement since ZIMRA was introduced in terms of systems, but you're right that the informal sector has not been part of the equation. For that, I advocate that we look at technological solutions, which is that maybe we start collecting taxes through mobile and airtime usage, you know, where because you know that, because money is fungible. It doesn't matter whether they're using it to fill their airtime and call or for productive purposes or whatever, it's still their resources. They are earning revenue somewhere. So find a point of collection which is easy to collect through. So through mobile phone, you start collecting taxes, we agree what makes sense at the informal sector. And almost everyone in the informal sector has a mobile phone, if not two, if not three. And maybe we start collecting taxes that way and try to then formalize that sector in terms of revenue collection. But in terms of formalizing the informal sector for the sake of it, I don't think we should spend a lot of effort doing that. I think the thing to do with the informal sector is provide the infrastructure that allows them to do what they do. If it's about electricity provision, for whoever is using electricity to do whatever, if it's about stalls where they sell their wares, make sure that those are provided, special spaces provided. The infrastructure to support the activities is all we need to do, and then find clever ways, technological ways to collect revenue from them.
Right. There will be a lot of young people in Zimbabwe who are very innovative, who are looking out for ideas, who hear about cryptocurrency and all the other things that are modern. When the Zimbabwean government or maybe the responsible institutions heard about that, even the central bank, they wanted to stop it until they can understand what it is and how it works. How would you advise a country like Zimbabwe with an advantage of jumping across technologically other people and other countries, where it could take advantage? Is this something it should worry about, or is this something that it could invest in understanding and exploiting?
I think the attitude for Zimbabwe is to invest in understanding these innovations. And often central banks are too slow in investing in these kind of technologies. But there are other countries which are moving faster. If you look at the Swiss Central Bank and other banks, they're investing in understanding Bitcoin. You can pay for your train, you know, travel in Switzerland using Bitcoin. So if these countries can see value, can see where this is headed, we should also pay attention. We have innovative youngsters, as you say. So my view is we shouldn't just the idea shouldn't be to stop it. Don't do this. It's risky. It's dangerous. But rather, the regulators must invest in catching up with them and then find ways, and once you understand it, then you regulate it because you now understand. So I would actually encourage the central bank to actually create a unit to try to understand a cryptocurrency. In fact, I'm on the board of OMFIF in London, which supports central banks around the world. And I've said to them, and I've said through the media because I'm not hiding this, is that we must actually train central bankers on cryptocurrency. What is Bitcoin? How does it work? What is Ethereum? There are so many of them that are out there, and we just have to understand them. But then encourage other innovation. You know, whether it's more other ways to do mobile payment, or whether it's using blockchain in terms of managing remittances across borders, because blockchain is nothing other than a trust machine. It allows you to track the authenticity of transactions to make sure that they're real, there's no fraud or whatever. So that's a great system. A trust machine is always a great system in finance. So investing in these technologies, understanding them from a regulator point of view is a good thing.
Right. I'm just getting some of the messages coming through social media because you're live. There are people who say it's a pity, it's too late, he should have been a presidential candidate. But there are others that are also saying any new government would not be clever or doing justice to Zimbabwe if they don't bring you into that government. Would that be something that you are receptive to?
Oh, I'm receptive to that. I'm always happy to contribute to Zimbabwe, making Zimbabwe better. This is my country of birth, absolutely. And I'm very passionate, generally, about Africa, very passionate. You know, when I was at the African Development Bank, I spent a lot of time just talking Africa to the world. I've been helping different governments across the world, from Ghana, Kenya, I mean, everywhere. So Zimbabwe still remains a key part of my heart. This is where I was born. So I'm very happy to assist if called upon.
Yeah. Lastly, Dr. Ncube, when you look at the sanctions and what has happened post-2002, Zimbabwe has struggled because most of the trade was with Europeans, but now it's mainly South Africa, and people have been trying to look east. So where do you think the priority should lie in terms of the direction of travel, negotiating or looking for new trade deals?
We should look everywhere, not east, not west, everywhere. That's the first thing to say. Secondly, because the relationship with the West has not been as good, maybe more emphasis should be placed there now so that we restore that relationship. For example, now we have got this Brexit in the UK. I think if UK people can ask me, well, what they really need now is friends within the Commonwealth. And in my view, Zimbabwe must join the family of the Commonwealth of Nations. Join the Commonwealth. Let's get back in there. And let's have, again, you know, trade arrangements with the UK, because they also need that because of their own, you know, fractures in terms of being involved in Europe through the Brexit process. So let's look everywhere. But again, don't ignore China. Why? That's where the money is. You know, everyone is looking to China. It's not just us. The whole of Africa, the whole of Europe, everywhere. This idea of the Chinese of the global Silk Road, it's real. And let's make sure that we don't, you know, lose out, at least benefit as much as we can. But let's negotiate well. Let's negotiate fairer deals. And also, maybe there's something to learn from the Chinese. Why is it that you go into the middle of some country in Africa where maybe even you and I are not even comfortable because maybe they speak a different language, but you find Chinese people there. They can't even speak the local language. They're doing business, they're trading. Maybe they understand risk differently. Maybe there's something to learn. There's always something to learn from others. So let's look everywhere to structure deals and not neither east, west, but let's get on with it.
Yeah, Dr. Ncube, thank you very much. That was Dr. Mthuli Ncube, one of the most prominent Zimbabweans who is being, he was doing a lot of work for a lot of countries outside his own country, but who has also alluded that if the opportunity does arise for him to serve his country, he will be prepared to do that. Thank you for watching, Dr. Ncube.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And good luck.
Enjoy.